Of course, this is really born out of a partnership with several people involved, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about what this lecture series is about, what it means to me as a forester. Obviously near and dear to my heart, talking about the landscape, removing exotic species, planting natives, all very good things in my book. But most importantly, it's about community, building capacity in a community, working with volunteers, working together to improve our landscape. And of course, we live in a historic national landmark, which makes it all the more important. To kick things off, I wanted to give a lot of credit to the partners at the table. Of course, as the name implies, from one arboretum to another, Riverside was recently designated as an arboretum. And another partner that we're working with is the Morton Arboretum, which is world renowned for their work with woody plants. They've been around the block a couple times, so we figured it would be good to learn from them, being that we're a newly established arboretum. And also, of course, our gracious host tonight, the Riverside Public Library, for bringing us in, but also, very importantly, the Frederick Law Olmsted Society, who I've worked with very closely since I've been here as a forester and has been a tremendous source of support in the landscape, especially from a volunteer aspect. Really, this lecture series, to me, is kind of a twofold purpose. Of course, one, providing educational experiences for our residents in the community and even non-residents, just getting the word out, important topics, how to manage your backyard or how to get involved. The other purpose I kind of have an ulterior motive, and don't worry, I'm not looking to sell you a timeshare or anything in the Caribbean. But really what we're trying to do is draw in the community to not only learn about these topics, but also give you an opportunity to apply these topics. For instance, tonight we're talking about controlling exotic species like buckthorn, garlic mustard. Well, it just so happens that we have a volunteer day coming up that's removing garlic mustard. Imagine that coincidence. Point being, not only do we want to talk about these things, but we want you to be involved in your landscape, of course, to a level that you're comfortable in doing so. It doesn't mean that you need to wield an axe or run a chainsaw, per se. Sometimes it can be as simple as just leading a small group of children and showing them how to pull a certain type of weed or whatever the case. So whatever your comfort level is, we want to welcome you in. And we want to partner with you, and all of the partners in the room that are involved in this are certainly willing to help teach you at whatever pace you're comfortable with. And I myself would be more than happy to work with you. So don't hesitate to reach out or even talk to us after the talk tonight. We'd love to hear from you. And on that note, I did want to give one of our partners, Cindy Kellogg, who's with the Frederick Law Olmsted Society, an opportunity to talk about some of our landscape work days that we have coming up and some of the neat things that the Olmsted Society has been up to. Cindy and I have been working together for probably 11 years or so, 12, give or take. But she will certainly provide some more information over all the wonderful things we have coming up this year. So, Cindy.
Thank you, Mark.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Oh! Blind.
Go this way.
Well, Mike introduced me, and I am the co-chair of the Landscape Committee of the Olmsted Society. And thank you so much for coming. I see some people who could really come and volunteer and help us. We work with Mike in clearing buckthorn, all kinds of invasive species, garlic mustard, and mulching. That's a big job. We're going to do that this Saturday at Long Common and Kent, or Long Common and Downey, right?
Maybe so, both.
Maybe
depending
both.
Depending on how many of you show up.
So we would love to have you come and volunteer. We always need help. And on April the 8th, Morton is going to be back at our work day, and they are going to hands-on show us how to do some things, like planting trees, so we all have a better idea of what's the proper way to plant a tree. And I belong to the Olmsted Society, and this coming year, 2018, they will be celebrating their 50th anniversary as an organization. So we have decided to plant 50 trees in the coming year, and we are going to start April 29th, where we're going to plant 15 trees and 9 shrubs over by Indian Gardens. And if any of you have driven by there, you will have seen how many trees Mike has taken out of there, and we're going to replenish and reforest those trees. There's handouts on the table, if you didn't get one, listing our work days for the whole year. Come and visit us. We'll be more than happy to put you to work, and I guarantee you, you'll have fun. Thanks.
Boy, 50 years, that's a milestone. And my hat's off to the Frederick Law Olmsted Society. You've been a tremendous amount of support. I'm really looking forward to the schedule that we have coming up. I also did want to give a chance, if the chair of the Landscape Advisory, did you want to make any announcements or anything in regards to upcoming? I know Landscape Advisory Commission has been working very diligently, and we have a lot of different things going on, so I just wanted to give Kathy Maloney, our chair, an opportunity to address the crowd as well.
Thanks, Mike, and I'll be brief so Lydia can finally get up here. I'm Kathy Maloney. The Landscape Advisory Commission is a group of appointed individuals who give advice to the Riverside Village Board about the public landscape areas in Riverside. So that would include the commons, the triangles, and the natural areas. There are three things that I'd like you to know about that are happening this year that you might want to get involved in, some of which we're doing in conjunction. Obviously, all we're doing in conjunction with Mike and the Department of Public Works, but also with the Olmsted Society. The first is Swan Pond is going to be having some new plantings put in. I described this in a previous, some of you who might have been here in a previous lecture would have heard about that. That'll happen in and around July. The plants are being ordered right now, so if you like to plant little plants that are native, that'll be fun, and we're looking for volunteers. We have two commission members here. Mary Plunkett is in the back taking names of people who might be interested in any of the floss work days or any of these things that I'm mentioning, and Julie Schaaf is over here, another commissioner. You can talk to her about any questions you may have. So the first thing is Swan Pond. The second thing, the master landscape plan, is something that the advisory commission is charged with doing by ordinance, and that is to prepare the ideal state, what we think the ideal state of the green spaces should be, and then essentially perform an audit, if you will, of the different triangles and parkways and so forth. So we'll be assessing throughout the summer different triangles to see which ones need more in-depth study. So if you live near a triangle and you have questions or concerns about it, let one of the commissioners know and we'll see if we can include it. We don't include all of them. Each year we try to rotate the ones that we look at. Lastly, in conjunction with being an arboretum, we're preparing some training and some scripts for people who might want to be a docent or a tour guide of Guthrie Park as it relates to being an arboretum. So if you like meeting with people and so forth, come on to the training. That should be sometime, probably this summer, I would guess. We'll announce it. So other ways to get involved. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Kathy.
All right. A lot of things going on. You know, just in closing, real quick, on the 28th, we will be planting a tree donated via Hop Stop, Frederick Law Olmsted Society, and Riverside Foods. We're going to have Ames School out for that tree planting. We're also going to be doing some tree tags, and I think a temporary exhibit may be in the works. So all sorts of fun things there. As you know, Arbor Day is always the last Friday in April, so plant a tree, everyone. And then, you know, really, let's just move on to Lydia. Lydia Scott is someone that I've worked closely with. She's the director of the Chicago Region Trees Initiative. She also manages the Community Trees Program at the Morton Arboretum. She is a certified arborist with the state of Illinois and then also received her master's in environmental sciences. But, you know, on a personal note, as a forester, Lydia has been, a tremendous amount of support for myself and other foresters in the region. And I think you guys are in for a real big treat tonight. So give a welcome to Lydia Scott, Morton Arboretum.
I'm here, as Michael mentioned, from the Morton Arboretum, but what Michael didn't tell you is that he's co-chair of the Tree Stewardship and Planting work group for the Chicago Region Trees Initiative, and we couldn't do what we do without him. He's been a tremendous resource to us, so I want to be sure we recognize his help and support. There we go. We got it. Did I get to the first one? Oh, we went too far. So the Chicago Region Trees Initiative was organized in 2013 by the Morton Arboretum in partnership with other organizations in the region. And the goal is to increase the health and vitality of our urban forest in order to improve our quality of life. So that's one of the most critical things that we can do in our region in order to help improve our quality of life. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. These are just some of the many benefits that trees provide for us. And we have a scientist at the Arboretum who just completed doing a literature review of the benefits that trees provide so that we can provide all the scientific references to argue and support any of the claims that we make. And if any of you are interested in a copy of that, we would be glad to get it for you. But for instance, one that we always get pushback on is that trees reduce crime. And they do reduce crime, but not that they go out and they catch burglars. It's that people that are outside enjoying nature and being around trees help reduce the incidence of crime. So there are a number of benefits that trees provide for us. In 2010, the Arboretum did a census with the U.S. Forest Service. And some of you have heard this census before, but I'm going to give you just a little bit of background on this. They surveyed 2,000 plots across the 7-county Chicago region, and what they found is that we have 157 million trees. And that sounds like a lot, but when you look at the number one tree forest at 28.2%, it's European buckthorn. That's the number one species in the Chicago region, and that's an invasive species, and we'll be talking a little bit more about that as we go through the evening. Second was ash. There's 8% of the region's trees are ash, and does everybody here know what's happened to ash trees in the region? Okay, emerald ash borer has killed them. That's 13 million trees in the Chicago region gone, absolutely gone. So when you look at that, those two things together, we have almost 40% of our region's trees that are either being killed by an invasive species or are an invasive species. So it's a pretty significant challenge for us. The other thing that I think is really important to note is that 73% of our trees are less than 6 inches in diameter. So that says, one, that we have a lot of buckthorn, because buckthorn is a smaller species tree, but it also tells us that our trees aren't growing to the sizes that they could because we're not either planting the right tree or we're not taking care of them correctly. And here in Riverside, you have an excellent forester, so you know that your trees here are being taken care of correctly. So you've got good future for your trees. But overall, the trees in our region provide $51.2 billion worth of benefits to us. And that's not counting any water issues, nor any of the health and physical benefits that trees provide to us. That is just air quality issues to us. $51.2 billion worth of benefits. That's a huge amount. And when you look at the expressways and all the cars that are on the expressways, and then you walk around and you look at the trees, you're not thinking that those trees are working the whole time you're standing there by them, but they are. They're working very hard at getting our air clean for us. One of the things that we've done is when we got that census and it showed us our region was in a state of transition, we wanted to be able to get analysis down to the community scale so that we could come out and work with communities like Riverside. We could provide data to Michael so that he's able to better understand how to manage this forest. And so what we did is we took LIDAR imagery that was flown by each of the 7 counties, and this is an image of what a point cloud looks like. We sent these images off to the University of Vermont, and they have a scientist there who's developed a model that can sort these point clouds into 7 land cover classes. And that's what this is here. It easily identifies for us trees and canopy, which is dark green, vegetation, bright green, bare soil, brown, water blue, buildings red, roads and rail black, and other paved surfaces is gray. The reason why this is important is because it easily identifies for us where we need trees, where we have trees, and opportunities to connect trees. And we're going to be talking a little bit more about that as we walk along too. When we take that data and we map it across the Chicago region, we can start to see where these issues are prevalent. So when you look at, and I'm going to walk here across, when you look at the yellow areas here, those are out in Kane County. That's low canopy. What do you think the issue is there?
Farmland.
That's exactly right. That's farmland. But when you look into around the city of Chicago, which is that bright green there, you've got these yellow areas. That's not ag land. Those are communities that are often underserved communities that don't have the resources that other communities have. And so they don't have the canopy that that we experience, and especially you here who have 50% canopy, one of the highest in the entire region. When you look at Riverside and you look at the communities up along the North Shore where the dark blue is, those are communities that have high canopy. So we know there's a correlation between income and tree presence. And there's a correlation between tree presence and increases in crime or lack of crime. There's evidence of a reduction in pulmonary disease and illnesses and presence of trees. For instance, in Minnesota, they did a big study where they showed that with all the trees, the ash trees coming down, that they noticed there was this climb or this increase in cardiovascular issues there in Minnesota. Cardiopulmonary issues there in Minnesota. So there are all these correlations that come into play, and we can start to look at those. And it's important to understand. So we've developed these maps and these opportunities to better understand. And if you go to the Chicago Region Trees Initiative website, there's this map here that you can see with the orange and the yellow and the green. If you click on your community, it'll pop up a little window like is shown there to your right. And it says Riverside, and it says name Riverside, house units 3,680, population 8,995, canopy 50%, and then it asks for more info. So you click that little more info button, and it takes you to a canopy summary page, which Michael has. He's seen this and has gone through this. You can see it's very data intensive, but it gives you an overview of your community so that you know a little bit more about why canopy is important and different things. So I'm going to tell you just a little bit about that. And I know this is off the topic of invasive species, but I thought you might be interested in hearing it. So here is your canopy distribution in Riverside. And you can see we have 50% canopy and you have 21% of vegetation. When we look at potential plantable space, and the reason this mapping has been done is so that we can identify where we can increase canopy. You look at potential plantable space, that is vegetation, it's bare soil, and other paved surfaces, because other paved surfaces can be parking lots where you can put in trees in islands and that sort of thing. In Riverside, you only have 28% potential plantable space. That is really a very low percentage when you compare it to other communities. We have some communities that have 4% tree cover in them, and they have lots of potential plantable space. So you really have a wonderful community with respect to the tree cover that you have here. What's important to understand, though, is when you look at land use and potential plantable space, you'll see there are two areas that pop up as great opportunity areas in Riverside. One is residential, where you can increase canopy, and another is in transit areas, where along your parkways, or along railroad corridors, or along, I don't know if you have an expressway that runs by town, I haven't looked at the map closely, so you're safe there. So you have, those are the areas where we need to be focusing on working with private property owners. 70% of the trees in the Chicago region are located on private land. And I think that's a very telling number for us, because we need to be communicating with individual property owners, folks like yourselves, in order to increase tree planting and care on your property. So we're starting to talk about diversity. We're going to get into invasive species here. One of the things, and this came up at dinner this evening, when you look at the species distribution based on your inventory in Riverside, you'll see that you have five species, your top five species. Oak is the number one species. I'm sorry, genera. The second is maple, elm, hackberry, and then linden. And that's by stem and by size. Why this becomes an important issue is that when you look at oak, it says 22%. Now, we know that ash trees across the region in parkways were about 16%. And that's been a catastrophic loss. So we want to be sure that we have broad species diversity, and that's, you know, mainly green ash, some white ash, some blue ash, but mainly green ash. We want to be sure that we're expanding our species diversity so that we don't have these kind of catastrophic losses. And so when you look at this oak number, you think, ooh, you know, maybe we've got too many oaks. The other thing is to think about, where is buckthorn on this list? Because I told you already that buckthorn was 28.2% of the region, which is an invasive species.
Other.
I'm sorry?
Is it under other?
Likely not. And I'll explain why that is in just a minute. And then, as I told you, 70% of the trees are on private land. This is why we don't want to have just one species or a few species. These are ash trees on one street where the entire street is out of trees. When you look at the oak species diversity in Riverside, these are all the different kind of oak trees that you have in your inventory here. And these are on public land. And the reason that buckthorn, and I'll have Mike tell me if this is true or not, the reason that buckthorn doesn't usually show up on public property inventories is because it's not maintained by the municipality, so they don't often inventory it. Is that your experience?
Yes, either that or we're just too ashamed to admit.
Okay. So, when you look at private property, and I can show you another table, I think, in this presentation. If not, I can tell you about it. But anyway, you can see that these are all oak species, and that on not one of them do you have more than 7%. You have 6% in bur oak. So that's really a great, great number. So you should be proud of that. When we think about this issue, though, we need to be thinking about expanding species diversity. So here are some species that did not show up on that previous page. So as you're thinking about planting trees on your property and your own lots, these are trees that you might want to consider. These are all native species, and they would be perfectly exceptional here. They would grow very well here. And Michael can tell you, is there anything on the list that shouldn't be planted here? Maybe?
Nope.
Okay.
We're good.
Okay, good. I tried to be very careful about that. Bald cypress, by the way, is one of my all-time favorite trees, and we talked about it at dinner. Sorry? Bald cypress. I just love bald cypress. Okay, so why do we worry about invasive species? One of the challenges for us is we're in the Chicago region, where a lot of goods and services go in and out of our area. We have all these rail lines that cross through Chicago. We have all these expressways that cross through Chicago. We've got Lake Michigan that is bringing in barges full of materials and things. Those materials are coming from China and Africa and South America and all over the world. And why is that a problem? Because it's bringing these pallets. And on these pallets, there are sometimes invasive species. And there are only a handful of inspectors from the U.S. Department of Agriculture who can go out and take a look at all these goods and services. So we need folks like you that are aware that there are potential invasive species that can come to our area and can keep your eyes out for them. Both emerald ash borer and Asian longhorn beetle were found by private citizens. They were not found by professional staff. It was people walking around in their yard and saying, gee, that bug looks a little strange to me. They reported it, and then it was clearly identified. The Asian longhorn beetle was actually here in the Chicago region. Does anybody know about that bug before? It was in the 1990s. It was found in Ravenswood. They found it, and they went through, and they cut down all these trees in Ravenswood in order to keep this bug from escaping. And it is one of the very few success stories that you can quote for the country in controlling invasive species like this. It was a success. Now, Asian longhorn beetle loves maple trees. It's their very favorite. If you have broccoli or chocolate, it will take chocolate every time, which happens to be maple. And it's in Ohio. So it's really only a matter of time before we start to see this in our area. So we need to have people very aware of what this insect looks like. And it is an unusual looking insect, so that we can keep our eyes peeled for it. These are invasive species that have the potential of really devastating our forest. And when we think about invasive species, it's not just buckthorn, it's not just garlic mustard, but it's these potential insects that come into our area. And it's not that they're bad insects, it's just that they're not in their element. where they're from. They have predators, and they've co-evolved with the species that are there. And that's why native species are so important to you and your community. The life, the wildlife and the insects and the birds that live here have co-evolved with the trees that are native to our region, and they rely on each other. It's a symbiotic relationship. Asian longhorn beetle and emerald ash borer are not native to this country, and so they don't have that symbiotic relationship. So here are two other species that were actually deliberately brought in. We've talked about buckthorn already. Buckthorn was brought in as a hedgerow. And they actually, at one time, had it at the Arboretum, the Morton Arboretum, and were using it decoratively for, you know, hedges in their, not in their plantings per se, but it was brought over. And then it was discovered to be invasive. And it wasn't, I'm not saying that the Arboretum was the one that brought it here, so don't get me wrong on that. But it was commonly planted here. When I bought my house maybe 25 years ago, there was buckthorn planted decoratively around my home, and I had no idea. So it was commonly planted, and now it's not. Garlic mustard was brought here because people that moved here wanted to have that herb in their dishes, so they brought it with them, so when they cook with it. So both of these plants were brought here for a specific reason, and yet they don't have any co-evolved predator that keeps it in check. Here are two more invasive species that are commonly produced and very commonly planted. One is the Calorie pear, the other is the Japanese barberry. Both were very commonly and still are very commonly planted. Calorie pear is often one of the top 3 to 5 plant or trees in many municipalities. Japanese barberry is very commonly planted in municipal plantings because it's very hardy, it stands up to salt, all those issues, but it's now being found quite prevalently in natural areas. So it's something to think about. So why is buckthorn a problem? Does anybody here have any guesses as to why buckthorn's a problem? Anybody have an experience?
It outcompetes all the native plants. It shades them out, it kills them, nothing can grow underneath the canopy.
That's right, it outcompetes. What happens, and you can see it in this picture, is the trees behind have no leaves on them. That's because they've all fallen off. But the buckthorn has leaves on it. So it keeps its leaves until after all the other trees have dropped all their leaves off. And in the spring, it leaves out before anything else leaves out. What happens then is because it's already leafed out, is creating shade so that other species can't grow underneath it. And it just continues to colonize and colonize and colonize. So it's a very detrimental species from that standpoint. I've heard people say to me, well, buckthorn berries are great for the birds, that it feeds the birds. Well, it's not a healthy food for the birds, and they've done nutritional studies to discover that it actually does not help birds. It makes them sick. And the scientific name is Rhamnus cathartica, which means that it gives you diarrhea. And that's what it does to the birds. And as a consequence, the birds eat those berries and poop the seeds all over the place. So as a consequence, it spreads itself all over. So what are management strategies for dealing with this invasive species? Does anybody here have buckthorn on your property? Okay, quite a few folks. It's a little bit of a process to get it going, but it's easily resolved. And some people don't like to take it all out at once, and I'll talk to you about that too in a minute. If you don't have the energy to take it all out at once, go after the females first. They're the ones with the berries, okay? Once you get the berries out, then you've got a little bit of time that you can go back in and get the males out. So start on those. It's really important when you're controlling buckthorn to cut it as close to the ground as you can and to immediately herbicide that stump. Now, some people don't like to use herbicide, and if you can get the stump out, more power to you. I can't do it after they're a certain size. The little ones you can hand pull. But if you take a cup of brush grade herbicide, and I would get the heavy brush you need to, when you go look for your herbicide or you buy Roundup or whatever you buy, you'll mix it so that it's for woody plants. I put it in a cup with a little sponge brush. You always want to make sure that you have rubber gloves on and glasses on, and I just wick that stump with that little bit of herbicide right there on the spot. Then it's done. And you move on to the next spot. The important thing to remember is that when you get the buckthorn down, it's been dropping seeds for several years. So as you get that shade out of the way and the sun hits those seeds, they start to pop up. When they come up new as little tiny sprouts, they're easy to pull out of the ground, and it's an easy thing to do in the fall and in the spring of the year when the ground is wet. so you don't have to use herbicide on those. If you do not herbicide that stump when you cut it, it's like a hydra. It sprouts up from its root system and you've got a mess to deal with. So if you don't like herbicide, be very careful with it and don't use very much of it, but you want to make sure you get it on that freshly cut stump. Don't even wait half a day to get it on there. I always went through and cut and then immediately herbicided right then and there, and it's an easy control when you do that. You may have to spend 1 or 2 years doing that, but once you get those big ones out, the little ones are easy to control and it's an easy thing to come back after. So just keep that in mind. And then when you have time, you can go back and get the males and be on your way. And once you get that buckthorn out of there, it's amazing what comes up underneath. You will be so stunned. You'll think that you didn't have plants under there. I loved walking past other people's properties and seeing trout lilies coming up and thinking, oh gosh, I wish I had trout lilies. As soon as I got that buckthorn down, I could see trout lilies starting to come up. I could see even some trilliums starting to come up, which was very unique for me. They didn't last long because we have deer, but anyway, they were cute for a while. But that's something to think about with them. The other thing to think about is doing something fun with your neighbors. And you could do this as a community project, is to have a buckthorn festival. We used to do this where we would cut the buckthorn, and keep in mind it's green when you're burning it, so it's smoky. But when you burn the buckthorn, you could cook your chili, or we did tacos, we've done cornbread and all kinds of other things, doing buckthorn cook-offs or buckthorn festivals. So think about doing that as a community activity. It's a fun thing for kids to get involved in because it's something that they can easily do. They can use little loppers, or even if they're a little bit older, they can do hand saws. It's a great thing to do as a community. Garlic mustard. Anybody here have garlic mustard on your property? Okay. As you know, garlic mustard is a real problem. I just really hate that little plant. You think you get it all out and it just all of a sudden you'll see a couple of them and you think you've got it completely eradicated, and the next year you'll see those little rosettes and you'll think, dang, I missed one of them. So garlic mustard is a problem because it's allelopathic. Do you know what that means? It creates chemicals in the soil that prohibit other plants from growing near it. So it's like allelopathic. So it's really important that you get it under control early on, or you will eliminate other plants that would normally grow there. Garlic mustard is a biennial, so that's a nice little thing to know about it because it gives you a good opportunity at getting it under control early on. Biennial means that it presents a rosette or a small, close to the ground flowering. It doesn't produce a flower, but you get these little heart-shaped leaves that look like a little rosette in year one. And it's not a problem then. It doesn't produce seed at that stage. It's year two. It sends up this little shoot with these, you know, it looks like it has maybe one or two little tiny flowers on it, but inside those nasty two little tiny flowers are millions and gazillions of little seeds. It's really awful. If you can get it at the rosette stage, you're much better off. And this one has to be hand pulled. If you don't hand pull it and get the root out, it just keeps coming back. You can spray herbicide it if you want to, but I think it's much better just to pull the rosette. If it goes past the rosette to where it pulls, it presents a little shoot and presents a flower on it, you've got to take the whole thing out and get it off your property. After it produces a flower, you're lost. It has a seed head in it, okay? So if you don't get it and you want to go back later and you think, oh, I'll just herbicide it, that won't help you because those seeds will still sprout. What you need to do is get the shoot out in year one. If you can't, then you've got to go back and pull it out in year two. And if you break off that stem and you think, oh, that's close enough, it'll produce a little flower that is on a stem like this tall. It's like, you know, you can do all you want to try and get rid of me, but I can get you. So it's just keep that in mind, that unless you get that plant out, it'll still produce a seed for it. So it's really important to pull out that rosette or the whole plant itself. And the seeds in the soil can take several years to exhaust. So just expect you're going to spend a little bit of time pulling that out. But you can do a garlic mustard cook-off. Garlic mustard really is a pretty tasty little herb. And there are recipes. There are actually natural cookbooks that you can use where people do foraging. And garlic mustard is one that's a great one to use because you want to get it all out. These are actually pictures of two garlic mustard dishes here. And in the Cuisinart are garlic mustard bulbs, the root systems for them. It does taste like garlic. So it's you know, it's very tasty to cook with. And one of the things I was looking at, they actually crowned a garlic mustard queen. So lucky you if you get that honor. But it's a great opportunity even to challenge kids to think of things, recipes that they could cook garlic mustard with. So anyway, something to think about. So I worked in a municipal government for almost 20 years before going to the Arboretum. And one of the challenges that I always ran into with my residents was I like my garlic or my buckthorn hedge. It screens me from my neighbor. I don't have to see my neighbor. Well, there are alternatives to a buckthorn hedge. And so I brought a list of things that I was just going to present to you here tonight for you to think about as alternatives for a buckthorn hedge if you're used to having that screening between your property and somebody else's. American bladdernut is a native shrub. It grows to about 10 to 15 feet tall. It gets these darling little seed pods on them and some pretty white blooms in the spring. And it's really a great plant for woodlands. And you don't have to prune it if you don't want to. You can manicure these to make them look like uniform privet hedges or whatever. But they can also just be freeform so that you're getting that screening. And it's important to think about, and I'll talk about this a little bit at the end, and we've talked about it already, is that shrubs are really important for birds. I don't know if you're aware of that, but birds really like to get in and about the shrubs. And so if you have one, the shrub provides a seed or food source for the birds, that's great. And two, it provides cover for them. So shrubs are really important for birds. American hornbeam, and this is a tree typically. But I actually was in Normandy, France, and I walked up to this hedge, and it was just gorgeous. And I looked at it, and sure enough, it was hornbeam. And at the Arboretum, they have there, and if you ever come out to the Arboretum, there are a series of shrub beds there that probably have 60 to 80 different kinds of hedges or shrubs that you can plant as hedges. And it's worth just coming to take a look at them, but they have hedges that are of hornbeam as well. And you see that beautiful fall color on it. It's really a great, great little tree or shrub. And it has these darling little seed heads that kind of hang down in little pendulums on them. They're really pretty. Another one is American cranberry bush. Viburnums, I think, are very common. And there's quite a few viburnums that are native to our area. This is one. You get these red berries that are great. And you also get the white flowers in the spring of the year, and then some of them turn absolutely beautiful fall colors. This is American hazelnut. Anybody here growing hazelnut? Oh, it is such a wonderful shrub. Look at those seed heads. Aren't those incredible? And I was talking to somebody the other day, and they said they wait for theirs to ripen so that they can go pick them, and the second before they go get them, the squirrels have gotten them. It's like they have, you know, some kind of radar or something that, oh, you know, in 2 minutes this thing will be ready, and they go get them. But the seed heads on those are just incredible. They're really a great, great plant. And so there's a great food source for wildlife. And it's a native shrub, and it's really a beautiful, beautiful little shrub. And it's 6 to 10 feet tall, full sun or part shade. Black chokeberry or Aronia melanocarpa. Now, it doesn't grow very tall. This one's only about, it says 3 to 8 feet, but I've never seen one get to 8 feet. It does get big black berries on it. As they ripen, they get black. So if you want to plant them, I wouldn't plant them near your sidewalk where you get black stains on there. It's sort of like a buckthorn berry, only like six times the size. But it's a beautiful native shrub, and it has really waxy green leaves on it. So it's really a great one to get. But again, if you don't like the blackberries, don't plant them where you're going to have to deal with them. The black haw viburnum is another one that's a native viburnum that really is a great one. And it gets nice color as far as the pinkish red foliage. And it gets black fruits. Some of them have red fruit, some of them have black fruit. This one has black. And when the leaves come out in the spring, they're a really pretty color. So this is a nice, nice one for you to choose from too. And it's a larger one. It goes about 12 to 15 feet. So that's another nice one for you. Buttonbush, look at that seed, isn't that great? That is just a beautiful seed. This is one that does really well in wet areas. So if you live along the river here or you have a wet spot in your on your property, this is really a great one to plant because it gets this beautiful, beautiful seed head on it. It's native, the flowers attract local native pollinators as well, so it's really a great one. Ninebark. is a great one. There's lots of cultivars of nine bark. There's one that's purple, and I think it's called Diablo nine bark. Are you familiar with that one? I know you're a garden person. This is the native variety. And it gets pretty bark on it, so there's kind of an interesting one to grow. So it's, you know, it's again, it's another opportunity for you. It says cultivars vary in size and color from purple to lime green. The purple ones I've seen revert back to the regular green, but it has a pretty leaf, and it's a nice shrub, and it's a dense shrub. So if you're looking for something for screening, again, that's another good one. Downy arrowwood is one that's not commonly planted or seen, and this one you'd have to be sure to go to a native nursery to get it. It's a shorter one, it's only 5 to 8 feet tall, but again, it's another viburnum offering for you, and it's related to the arrowwood viburnum. The maple leaf viburnum is another one, and this is pretty, and it does have very maple-shaped leaves to it. It's a shorter variety as well, 4 to 6 feet, so if you're interested in one of those, that's another good one. It has black fruit again, and it gets pink to burgundy in the fall. Shingle oak. I was walking out through the hedge bed at the Arboretum, and I walked up to it and I thought, gosh, that looks like a shingle oak. And it was, sure enough, it was. And what they did is they topped it so that it creates this beautiful hedgerow. So it's an actual shingle oak that's been topped, and as it creates this, this thicker horizontal branching rather than the vertical branching, and it really is gorgeous. So if you and it holds onto its leaves all winter, so that you get that winter and summer screen that you may not get with some of the other ones. But it really is a great one if you want to try that as a shrub, and you know, if you want to continue with the native oaks, that's another good one. All right, I'm going to talk just a little bit about some plants that you can use to replace your garlic mustard. At the end of the slide, I have some lists of some nurseries that you can go to online, and I'm not promoting those nurseries for purchasing. I'm just simply pointing you there because they have fabulous photos of native plants. And if you're interested in any kind of ground covers or native plants that you want to plant under your woods, under your trees, it's a great place to go and just sort of just peruse them, do your little window shopping, and then take your list with you to a nursery to purchase your plants. There are a number of ferns that are great in this area. And you don't have to have, you know, color always in the spring, or purple or and white flowers on things. And if you have heavy shade, oftentimes you're not going to get a lot of color, especially after spring. So be thinking about planting ferns. Ferns are really a great source for ground cover for you. And many of them will perpetuate themselves by sending out seeds and moving around your garden. So consider those. These are just some of the native ones that you can get. And before I forget, I brought some sheets here that have some plants, native plants and ferns and information up here. So please come help yourself. When I'm through, you can come get those. There are sedges. Sedges are, they look like grasses, but they're not. They're actually triangular in shape at the base. There's a number of sedges that you can choose from that are very popular, and they have these interesting little seed heads on them that can make them very interesting in your garden. So consider planting sedges, and these are just a few. There are a gazillion different kinds of sedges to choose from, and many of the native nurseries stock these now much more prevalently than they used to. Anemone canadensis is one of the darling little flowers for a woodland garden. It gets this pretty little white flower on it, and it looks almost like they're a little nodding to start with, and then they open up. It's a pretty white flower. It blooms in the spring, and then you have this pretty green foliage throughout the summer. It's 1 to 2 feet tall, so it's fairly short. I actually haven't seen them much over about 12 inches in height, so 2 feet would be pretty high. Full sun to part shade is fine, and they colonize, so you can get a pretty nice ground cover with those. Wild ginger. Anybody here use wild ginger?
I do.
I love that one. It has that darling little burgundy red flower underneath, and it's such a pretty little ground cover. It's not real aggressive, so it won't spread real fast, but it has these heart-shaped leaves, and they're pretty waxy, so it's really a great little ground cover for your woodland garden. Bloodroot. I love bloodroot. Does anybody else have bloodroot? Oh, I just love bloodroot. It gets this pretty little white flower on it, and then the flower goes away, and the leaves get a little bit bigger in size, and they've got such an interesting shape to them that they make an interesting asset in your garden. So think about bloodroot. It's an easy one to plant. Mine seem to come up again and again, and the deer don't seem to bother it, which is huge. I don't know if that's just an anomaly or what, but mites persist, so apparently something's working. Goat's beard. Goat's beard is one that I have had trouble with deer. Anybody else here have trouble with goat's beard and deer?
So, we have deer, but it grows really well in our garden.
It's a great plant. For people that like a stilbe or a stilbe type plants, it's very similar to that in its appearance. It gets a little larger in size than most stilbes do. It's a beautiful plant, so if you don't have a lot of problems with deer, it's a great plant to plant. This is mist flower. I've never actually tried growing this. Has anybody here tried growing mist flower? Yes. Did you have any luck with it?
Not yet.
Okay. You're hopeful? Well, you let us know if it worked out well. I just thought it was so beautiful when I was going through the native plant list, and it's one that I haven't tried, but I will try it, and I'll let you know, too. But it goes about 1 to 3 feet tall, and it's full sun or part shade. Geranium. Geranium is a great one because the deer don't seem to bother that one. It comes back year after year after year. It's just really a great all-around plant, and it'll go, you know, full sun or part shade. I had almost full shade. I had 200 ash trees on my property. You feel bad for me now? That was really horrendous. So I have little trees that are growing up, but they're not quite there yet. So all my landscaping was for shade tolerant plants, and now I've got like full sun. So the geraniums seem to still do okay. Mayapple. Mayapple is a great one too. I love mayapple. It has also another little red flower. Is it red or white that's the flower underneath? White? White that's underneath. But it's a great little plant too, and it's a shade type plant. Here's Solomon's plume, which again is another beautiful plant that's for full sun or part shade. And I'm sorry, partial to full shade is what I mean to say. It's a shade plant. And a lot of these are shade type plants just simply because I focused on plants that would grow well in a woodland where your garlic mustard would be most common. So here's some of the nursery catalogs you can look at online. Taylor Creek Nursery, Prairie Nursery, or JF New both have really good photos and descriptions of their plants. Midwest Ground Cover has a tremendous list, but they don't have photos there, but it may give you some more plants to choose from than some of these others. And if does anybody else here have a favorite catalog they like looking through for native plants? Anybody? Yes?
Are you referring to Prairie Moon Nursery?
No. The Prairie Nursery is up in Wisconsin. I don't know where's Prairie Moon Nursery.
I'm not certain, but
okay.
I think your catalog.
Okay. They have great natives too, so Prairie Moon Nursery would be another one. Most of these places will mail you plants in the mail, so if you pick out things that you want, they'll mail them to you. But again, they have excellent descriptions for their plants as well. So why do we care about natives? Natives are important, again, as I said, because they support species that have co-evolved with them. These are some critical wildlife that are supported by our oak woodlands. You've got this blue-spotted salamander. You've got the wood frog. I'm not a big bird. I love birds, but I don't know them very well. The black-billed cuckoo, the red-headed woodpecker, which you think you see it, but you really don't. There's other woodpeckers that you see out there. The red-headed woodpecker is not as commonly found anymore. And then you've got the northern flicker, which I think is trying to dig a hole through my house. Anybody else having lots of trouble with flickers? They seem to be pretty prevalent, but the oak species that you have here really do support a wide assortment of wildlife. And this is the end here, but I wanted to point out to you that Chicago Wilderness and the Morton Arboretum wrote last year the Oak Ecosystem Recovery Plan. And if you have a chance to read this plan, it's fascinating because it talks about oaks as they've evolved from pre-settlement times to now and the impacts that they've experienced, and provides recommendations on how we can improve oak ecosystems. When we did that census that I talked about at the beginning in 2010, what they found is that most of our oaks in the Chicago region are larger than 18 inches in diameter, and we're seeing very few smaller age classes of oaks. Oaks are not regenerating, and one of the challenges is that oaks need sun to grow. So you'll get little tiny ones that'll start off, and one, either the deer will braise them down or browse them down, or bunnies will get them, or they're not getting enough sun to grow past that point. So we need to be thinking about how we can create landscapes that will support our native oak ecosystems, because oaks are keystone species for us in our region. They are our natural heritage. So when you look at oaks across the region, they've been segmented or broken up by roads or development or other things. And this happens to be the Des Plaines River. When you look through the area and you see that where the dark gray area is where oaks were in pre-settlement times. The blue area is 2010, where you'd see oaks, and then the green is showing where there are possible connections to those. We need to be thinking about each of our backyards as opportunities to connect one oak ecosystem to the next, so that as birds fly through and as wildlife moves through, that they can go from one source of protection or food or other needs that they have to another. And our backyards may be some of the best ways for them to do that. So here is Riverside. The dark gray is where oak ecosystems existed pre-settlement. The bright green is where oak ecosystems were in 2010, and the blue are oak ecosystems from 1939, and that's when one of the first aerial photographs took place. So you can see that oak ecosystems here, even in your community with all the oaks that you have, are still very limited. So if you're thinking about planting, think about planting oaks and other native species that will support the wildlife that we rely on and that we can help recover due to buckthorn, garlic mustard, construction, development, all these other impacts that have created significant problems for us in our region. It's been my pleasure to talk to you tonight, and I don't know if we have time for questions or not. We have time for some questions. Do you want to talk first? Okay, so I'm going to let Emily talk next. Emily is our stewardship coordinator at the Arboretum, and she's going to take just a few minutes to talk to you about stewardship.
Thank you.
Do you need me to load up here?
Oh, sure. Thank you. So my name is Emily Ogallow, and I'm a project coordinator at the Arboretum in the Community Trees Program. I just want to say, I hear Lydia speak all the time, and I learn something new every single time, and not just one thing either. Sort of an endless wealth of knowledge. So thank you, Lydia. So I'm here to talk to you tonight about my program, which is called the Community Tree Champions, and it's a new initiative at the Arboretum, and it seeks to address gaps in municipalities where the municipal staff is sort of unable to meet the labor demands of keeping the ecosystems and the trees healthy. Okay, so Lydia talked about the benefits of trees, but I thought I would go through them very quickly. I love trees, obviously. I work at the Arboretum. I studied trees. I used to swing from trees like monkeys with my sister when I was a kid. I love being in the forest, but I understand that, you know, that's sort of, not everybody does that, and that's okay. But it's also important to recognize that trees do a lot of things for us. They make us happy. They make places beautiful. You know, as Lydia pointed out, they reduce crime rates. They also make us healthier. They make us feel 7 years younger and $10,000 richer when we live on tree-lined streets. And they help with other afflictions or whatever it may be. You might heal faster if you have surgery or if you're sick, if you are in a hospital room where you can see trees. They also help to reduce stormwater, and they intercept rain. They might help with standing water. And these are just, you know, these are just benefits, you know, the social and physical and stormwater benefits as well as the financial ones. But there are environmental benefits, obviously. We talked about wildlife. We talked about habitat for wildlife. And there's obviously also a ton of benefits as far as pollutants and reducing and improving air quality. So these are the references that I quoted. These are the articles that I quoted just in those benefits that I listed. These are the articles that I quoted, but there's so much science out there. I mean, this is just a drop in the bucket of the research that's been done as far as the benefits of trees. And there are benefits to working with volunteers, to helping to work with trees in your community. Obviously, it helps you to feel more connected to your community. It helps you to feel more connected to your public works people, your forester. And it helps you to provide labor in areas where maybe your community, your municipality, and when I say municipality, I mean, you know, the entire community, so the entire village, whatever it may be. It might be your park district, it may be anything related to the care for trees. And there's a monetary value to that. It's been calculated by the government. and it also helps you to understand how your village works. So, you know, Mike obviously does a ton of work in the village, and he works with us with CRTI. And maybe you don't know that, but if you work more closely in caring for trees, you'll get an understanding of what actually all the work that goes into helping the trees be successful. And ultimately, it can help you to become an advocate for trees. And an advocate, and that might be in your own backyard. That might be that you're able to better care for your own property, or it might be that you are able to do that on a municipal level. Maybe you're able to go to your village and say, hey, you know, I learned this great thing about trees, and I want to see this implemented. And then Mike's going to be really mad at me that I taught you those things, because I'm just going to create more work for him. Or maybe he'll be happy that you understand, you know, what he does. So our program is a collaboration. I like to think that I'm going to facilitate, you know, the work that that community tree champions are going to do with your village. We want you to care for trees, mostly. We want to make sure that the trees that get planted, you know, you can't just put a tree in the ground and then be done with it. You have to go back and you have to water it in the first couple of years. You have to make sure that it's mulched properly. You have to make sure that, you know, it's pruned. And these are things that you as residents can do. When you're walking your dog in the morning, you know, you can look at a tree and say, oh, that tree's not looking so great. Maybe it needs to be watered because we haven't had any rain in a while. And you might be able to look at trees and say, oh, that one looks like maybe it has something going on. You know, is there a pest that's come in? Is there a disease that it's developing? You can help Mike perform inventories so that we can go back and measure how trees are doing. Are they, you know, are they growing the way that they're supposed to be growing? Do we have the species diversity that we want to have in the village? These things need to be updated, and it's very time consuming, but it's also something that's fun because you get to go look at trees all day long, which is what people want to do, right? It's not just me. Other people want to do that. Go hug trees. And finally, we want to teach you to educate and advocate. So if you're able to go in and just tell your neighbor, you know, that mulch pile over there, that volcano mulch is maybe not the best thing. Maybe I can show you how to do that so that it's a little bit healthier for the tree. Then that's something that would be great. Then you get to teach other people. And then you get to take it home, obviously, and have the best yard in the neighborhood. So we all know that Riverside has really great trees, right? Lydia was saying that you have one of the best percentages in the region. So why exactly does Riverside need help? And that's because trees in this area, because it is an urban area. I mean, I know it's suburban here, but trees in this area are, you know, they need help. They're sort of beat up. They're planted in very small spaces, close to cars, with bikes chained to them. They're subject to diseases and and pests and other types of pests. And also because we have terrible winters. Sometimes, I guess, not this year. But I want to highlight the ice, right? All this ice on the road. And that's really difficult for trees because all that salt changes the chemistry in the soil. And then also, dogs appreciate trees. And they don't quite do this, but some people think that that's exactly what they do, right? So, you know, that being said, Riverside is pretty well off when it comes to trees, but these are things that need to be protected. You can't just, you know, look at what you have and consider that the job is done. Because, I mean, you have arboretum designation, but if you don't plant more trees and you don't make sure that the regeneration is there and that the younger trees are coming in and they're getting well established, then that's something that can, you know, disappear. So Lydia talked about this, so I'm not going to go too far into this because, you know, you guys are doing really well. But you have opportunity to do better. That 28% of plantable space is something, you know, that you have the capacity to take advantage of if you can get the labor in to be able to do that and to take care of those trees. And same goes with tree diversity, because if something comes in and, you know, unfortunately attacks one genera of trees, then you're going to be left with an entire, you know, chunk of this pie, of this pie chart that's missing. And so we want to make sure that we increase that diversity. And that's something that we want to do. The Arboretum wants to help Riverside accomplish these goals. So we are offering training for whoever wants to participate in a stewardship group. We will come to Riverside. We will train you on whatever topic you deem, you know, enjoyable and something you'd like to work with. And Mike allows us to do as well, because this is a collaboration with the village. And we will make sure that Mike stays on task and gets things done. yeah. But, you know, we want to make sure that you as stewards are able to participate in activities, and in order to do that, we want to make sure that the village provides opportunity for you to do that and provides the capacity for you to do that. And we will also provide networking. So we are establishing these groups, these stewardship groups, throughout the region. And in the future, we're hoping to be able to hold events where you may be able to speak to tree champions in other areas and talk to them in other neighborhoods or other villages and talk to them about their experiences and sort of share your experiences and maybe, you know, your challenges and find solutions. And I want to stress that this is a partnership. We are here. We're going to train you. We're going to provide continued training. You can come to us with any questions that you have about anything. And we will do everything we can to find opportunities for you to do the work that you want to do. So if you don't want to plant trees, that's perfectly fine. Maybe you want to, you know, spend time in schools educating kids or providing, you know, after school programs. Or maybe you want to go sit in Mike's office every day and tell him what you want and be an advocate. He's shaking his head. He doesn't want that. We won't do that one. But whatever it is, we'll find an opportunity for you to participate in the care of trees in Riverside. So my name is Emily. I have cards, I have flyers, I have a sign-in sheet where you're welcome to point and where you're welcome to write down whatever stewardship activities that you'd like to participate in, and I would love to hear from you, and we would love to get stewards established in Riverside. Thank you. So Lydia, do you want to come back up and we'll take questions? Or Mike, did you, I'm sorry.
Oh no, that's all right.
Okay.
A round of applause for the folks from
home. Oh no. Well, thank you.
Boy, that was a great talk, wasn't it? A lot of tie-ins, especially to our community. You know, when you're talking about native shrubs and underplanting underneath trees, that was obviously something that was a big part of Frederick Law Olmsted's design for the village of Riverside, that multi-layered canopy effect. So that's a great tie-in to the community. And then, of course, the garlic mustard, just to reiterate again, April 29th, we are doing a garlic mustard pull over by Indian Gardens. We are going to have RB students with their day of service. And then we also plan to lead some tree planting with the students. And, you know, going back to Emily's training that she's talking about, on April 8th, we have a volunteer work day with the Frederick Law Olmsted Society, where we will have staff from the Morton Arboretum on site that is going to train volunteers in how to lead small groups in planting trees. So if you'd like to be a part of that, we would love to have you. But beyond that, you know, what a great evening. Thank you so much for coming out. And if you want, one last thing. The village board has been a tremendous support over the past couple of years in terms of reforestation after trying to mitigate the losses we had with emerald ash borer. I am offering out free parkway trees with the condition, one, that I get to pick the tree. We're trying to increase that species diversity that Lydia spoke of, but also you have to actually have a gap where I can fit a tree. But if anyone's interested, whether here tonight or out in TV land, I would love to hear from you, but the trees are going quickly, so please reach out as soon as you can. If not, maybe we can start a list, okay? But other than that, thank you again, Lydia, Emily, and thanks you. Oh, sorry, Lois? Oh, okay. So I'm selecting tree species for people's parkways. We're more than happy to give out, or we are offering free parkway trees, but with the caveat that you would be willing to water Thanks for making me do this again, Lois. That's I'm making better points the second time around. But anyway, we are looking to find homes for parkway trees. Of course, there's some hoops that we have to jump through, and I would like to evaluate each site. But if you'd like to reach out to me, I'd be happy to meet you at your residence, and we could discuss some options.
Who does the planting of parkway trees?
Oh, the village. Generally speaking, so we have bald cypress. We're doing a triumph elm, which is a disease-resistant elm. Yellowwood, sour gum, sweet gum. I have some oaks, but I'm kind of trying to hold on to those for the park areas. But you may be able to talk me into it. And London plane tree exclamation, which is a sycamore that's very similar to a sycamore, but with disease resistance. And that's about all I have off the top of my head. But if you're interested, please reach out to me. I'd be happy to meet with you. So, and then once again, thank you to the Morton Arboretum for coming out tonight. We're looking forward to many more lectures, so stay tuned. Oh, sorry. Sure, you mean in terms of private property or? Yes, I'm always happy to consult, you know, to a certain extent. I mean, I have a mission statement with the village and I try and stay on task, but I'm always happy to take 5 or 10 minutes to do outreach, because really when it comes down to it, we're all one urban forest. Just because the municipality's line ends here and your line starts there, it doesn't mean that we're not all getting these benefits. So I'm always happy to help.
Is the information about the tree giveaway on the village website?
I believe we've e-flashed a couple times the reforestation efforts, and it is up on the website. I'm not sure if it's under the trending or if it's kind of kicked back. It was probably, last time I e-flashed, it was about a week and a half ago, I think. So, any other questions, thoughts, concerns? All right. Oh, sorry. Don't see you back there. Oh, okay.
Native oaks in the parkway? Yeah, I know it's bright.
Yeah.
Have you had any luck with bur oaks as a parkway tree, or white oaks are kind of sensitive?
Oh, yes. White oaks are a little harder to come by in the nursery trade these days, but bur oaks, swamp whites tend to do well, even some chinkapins. Red oaks. I mean, you'd be surprised. They do fairly well. And the good thing with Riverside is our soils are fairly undisturbed compared to a lot of communities that were developed later. So we have that luxury where our soils are a little bit more kinder and gentler to our native plants. So, yeah. Yep. If anyone has a question, shout it out. I can't see you that far. No? Oh, yes, Lois. Well, knock on wood. So far, we've been doing okay. We did have the Department of Agriculture spray. I believe that was back in 2007 or 8. But for the most part, what they've found with gypsy moth is that it can persist in the environment at low levels, and it doesn't have that much of an impact. That being said, if you get 3 repeated defoliations on an oak, you're likely going to lose it. I haven't really heard of any major outbreaks in this immediate area. I think the red line of advancement for gypsy moth is past us, and we're just kind of dealing with it. I occasionally run across an egg mass, but I've never seen any large populations since that spray. So, fingers crossed. Anyone? All right. I'm going to officially close this out this time. Thank you all for coming.